in order to figure out the shear stress at point C on a T beam cross section of an overhanging beam that is under the distributive loading of rectangular and triangular form at a location where the internal shear force is maximum, and also to represent the results on a volume element, we can start by writing our shear stress formula. That is, tau is equals to Vmax times QC over IT. Here, tau is the shear stress that we are looking for. Vmax is the maximum shear force acting across that beam, whereas QC is the moment of area at point C, whereas I is our section property of moment of inertia, and T is the thickness at that specific point where we are going to calculate our shear stress. So once we have this relation, we can go ahead and first start looking for our shear force. To calculate the maximum shear force acting throughout the beam, we have to develop our shear force diagram. So to do that, I have my two supports at point A and B. At point A, we have a pin support, and at point B, we have a roller. So first of all, we have to figure out these support reactions and then move to calculate our shear force diagram. So to start, let us divide our distributive loading of 20 kN per meter into a point load by multiplying that 20 with 3, that gives us a point load of 60 kN. Similarly, by calculating the area of the right angle triangle, we can convert this distributive loading into a point load. Here it is half times base, that is 1.5 meter, times the height of the triangle of 30. This gives us a point load of 22.5 kN. Next, the location of these point loads also needs to be identified. These point loads will act at the centroid of the area. So for the rectangle, it will be in the middle, so 1.5 meter from point A, whereas for the triangular loading, it is 1/3 from the higher end of the triangle, so 0.5 meter from point B. Once we have the loads and their position, let's go ahead and write our equilibrium equation. So we will start with the summation of moment at point A equals to zero. And since AY is acting at point A, it won't create any moment, whereas our 60 kN force is going to create our clockwise moment with a moment arm of 1.5 meter. Next, I have our support reaction at point B that is going to create our counterclockwise moment having a moment arm of 3 meters. And finally, a point load of 22.5 with a moment arm of 3.5 creates our clockwise moment. Simplifying, we get our value of By as 56.25 kN. Next, we can go ahead and write our second equilibrium equation of summation of forces acting in the vertical direction equals to zero. Here, Ay is going upward, so taken as positive, minus 60 as it is going in the downward direction, then positive By, that is 56.25, and the negative 22.5 kN of load acting in the downward direction. This gives us our Ay value of 26.25 kilonewtons. Now, once we have these support reactions of Ay and By, we can proceed and draw our shear force diagram. So basically, the idea of developing this shear force diagram is to identify what is the maximum shear force acting throughout the span of the beam. So to start, we can utilize a graphical method of drawing the shear force diagram. And one of the rules of that is wherever there is a point load, there will be jump across our shear force diagram. So at Ay, since the load is 26.25, our shear force diagram will jump from 0 to 26.25 kilonewton. Next, I have this distributive loading of rectangular form having an area of 60 kilonewton. Now, to utilize our graphical method, what we do is we subtract this area of 60 kilonewton from 26.25 as it is acting in the downward direction. This will give us the point where this area ends. That is coming as negative 33.75 kilonewtons. Now the profile, how the value changes from 26 to 33, comes based on the slope of the distributive loading. Since we have a constant slope, therefore we have our linear profile on the shear force diagram. Next, at BY, I have a point load acting in the upward direction of 56. So we just add 56.25 with the negative 33.75. It jumps up to 22.5 kilonewton. After that, the area of the triangular loading is 22.5. So subtracting that from 22.5 gives us the value of 0. Now the profile is, in this case, since on the load is linear, so on shear force diagram it will be of quadratic nature. Now the highest point on this diagram is of negative 33.75 kilonewton. That is the maximum shear force. Just keep in mind the negative sign is just indicating the direction, so we are mainly looking for the maximum magnitude here. Now once we have that, let's go ahead and figure out our moment of inertia that is required in our formula as well. To solve for the moment of inertia, we first have to identify the centroid of this composite structure. Since I have a T cross section, so we can divide this structure into two rectangles and first calculate the centroid of this shape. To do that, we can first identify the centroid of each one of these rectangular areas, and then from there, utilizing our formula of centroid of an individual area multiplied by the area and add them all together divided by the total area will give us the centroid of the whole structure. So to start, our area 1 has a height of 200 millimeters, so the centroid of that will be in the middle of this rectangle, that is 100 millimeter from the base, whereas for the second area the height is 20 millimeters, so it will be 10 millimeter from the top of this T cross section. Now just keep in mind, just pick a constant reference point wherever we are going to utilize and measure where our centroid lies while we are plugging it in the formula. So for the area 1, the distance is 100 millimeter, in meters it is 0.1 times 0.02, that is the width, times 0.2, that is the height of that rectangle. Now for area 2, the centroid location of that particular rectangle is 210 millimeters from the base. That's why we have utilized our 0.21 in meters for the y prime value of that rectangle, multiplying it with the area as well and dividing it with total area of the T cross section. We can get our centroid value that is coming as 0.155 meter. Now again, this number is measured from the same reference point. Since we have taken all the values from the base of that T-beam, our centroid location will also be 0.155 meter from the base of that T-beam cross section. Next, we can go ahead and now solve for our moment of inertia value. Now, in this case, since it is a composite body, we have to calculate the moment of inertia about the neutral axis, that is the centroidal axis. So we have to utilize our parallel axis theorem. So the formula for the moment of inertia will be IC. That is the moment of inertia about the centroidal axis of that individual area, plus area of that region times dy square. This dy is basically the parallel distance from the centroidal axis of that specific area to the centroidal axis of the whole composite beam. Similarly, we have the second area. So again, our term IC plus ADY square is being present for the second area as well. Now, the value of IC is for the rectangle is 1 over 12 BH cube, where B is the base of the rectangle and H is the height of the rectangle. So to start, for area 1, the base is 20 millimeters, whereas the height is 200 millimeters. Next, we have the area of this region as 20 times 200 millimeter times dy1 is square. dy1 is square is the distance from the neutral axis of this whole composite structure to the centroid of the individual area. Here it is equals to 0.055 meter. Next, we can repeat the same process for the second area. Again, in this case, the base of the second area is 200 millimeters, so 0.2, whereas the height is 20 millimeters, so 0.02 meter cube, plus, again, the area of that region times our dy2 is square in this case, where dy again is the distance from the centroid of that area to the centroid of the composite structure. So our value of dy2 is coming as 0.055 meter as well. Once we compute all of this, the final value of moment of inertia is coming as 37.66 10 raised to power negative 6 meter raised to power 4. Now, once we have the moment of inertia, next let's go ahead and solve for our moment of area at point C. Now, this value of QC, again, let's draw the cross section. So we have our T beam and point C lies just below the bigger rectangle that is present at the top. So we have to calculate the moment of this specific area either above this point or below this point. In this case, I'm going to select the area that is above point C. Now, for the moment, I also need the moment arm. So the moment arm is basically calculated from the centroidal axis of the area to the neutral axis or the centroid of this whole cross section. So our value of Q is equals to the moment arm, that is Y bar prime in this case, times the area. So the value of Y bar prime is also coming as 0.055 meter in this case, whereas the area is 200 millimeters times 20 millimeters again. So the value of QC is equals to 0.22 10 raised to power negative 3 meter cube. Now, once we have the moment of area as well, the only thing that is left in the formula is the thickness, since point C lies just below that vertical region, or even if the point C lies at the transition between the above rectangle and the below rectangle, we are going to select the value of thickness of 20 millimeter because this is the smallest value and we are calculating the maximum shear stress at point C. So smaller the thickness, higher will be the value of shear stress. Next, let us plug in all the values in our formula of tau is equals to V max. The V max is negative 33.75 kilo. Here kilo is represented at 10 raised to power 3. Times QC, that is 0.22 10 raised to power negative 3 divided by moment of inertia of 37.66 10 raised to power negative 6 and times the thickness of 0.02 meter. This gives us our value of negative 9.86 megapascal. Negative sign is just showing us the direction of the shear stress. So to draw this thing on the volume element, since it is negative, so on the right hand side of the cube, it will be going in the upward direction of 9.86, whereas on the left hand side, it is going downward to maintain equilibrium. Also, since these two direction of the forces is going to create our counterclockwise moment, the top and bottom will be in the direction that is going to counteract that moment to maintain equilibrium.